Welcome to this May edition of Customer Focus, a program intended to give our customers information about the Metro Transit system and how it relates to them. It's been a busy month for Metro, and we have Robert Baer here, President and CEO of the agency, to talk to us about the funding issues that have been going on with Metro and what's been going on at the state of Missouri level. So welcome, Bob.
Thank you.
And tell us, you've been spending a lot of time with state legislators in Jefferson City. What do you expect will be the outcome?
Well, first of all, we have spent a lot of time, and we've gotten a very good reception. And I think that's important not only for now, but for the future. Mm-hmm. What we're hopeful is that we're going to get $12 million that will come to the region for transit. That will enable us to restore some part of the service that we had to cut. It'll get some of our jobs back. It'll help many people get back to their jobs. It'll access to schools, medical appointments, and things of that nature. And important to us, of course, is it will be a great benefit to the elderly and disabled community who have no option other than call a ride.
Well, $12 million is a lot of money. So some people watching will want to know if this fixes everything. Will Metro be okay now? And if not, what are you doing to keep the agency stable?
Well, the first answer is no, it does not fix everything. Okay. This is a one-time emergency appropriation, and it will provide a portion of the service lost for a period of about 1 year. While it's really, greatly appreciated by Metro, all of our customers that we serve, and everyone in the region, everyone concerned about transit, everyone knows that this is not a permanent fix and that we're going to have to come up with other sources of revenue. And that's what the region really needs, a permanent solution to financing. And we believe it needs to come from three levels, local, state, and federal. Now, first of all, we'll talk about local because that's the most visible and the most things we can get our hands on. For example, St. Louis County is going to, again, put on the ballot in April of 2010 a half-cent sales tax for Metro. So given the awareness and people now understanding the importance and the consequences of reduced service, we're hopeful and we believe that by talking to people as we have for the last year, mm-hmm. that they will support the initiative. Okay. Secondly, at the state level, hopefully, and again I say hopefully because until we have cash in hand, it's just that, hopefully. But hopefully $12 million will be coming to Metro from the state. That will be the most state support Metro's ever had, ever. Mm-hmm. And again, I think you know and probably others that the state of Illinois supports St. Clair County, the east side of our system, to the tune of about $20 million a year. They do that consistently. The third part of that formula in our judgment is that it's time for the federal government to rethink its position on operating subsidies. Okay. They did that for a long time and they cut it off, but it is critically important. They have all the stimulus money, all the other funds that are floating around. We think it's important for not only St. Louis but other transit systems throughout the country to have some federal support.
Well, can you help, though, with why the funds are needed? You just said something about the federal funds went away and they weren't replaced. But how do you explain to people who would say, live within your means, there's a perception Metro's always asking for money? How do you explain the need for additional funds?
Again, I think it's a very good and fair question, and I think it's a great opportunity for us to clarify what Metro has done. First of all, think of yourself as an individual who hasn't gotten a raise or any new source of income since 1994. 1994 is the last time that we've gotten any new money, so to speak. Since then, however, the community has grown, the demand for transit has grown tremendously, and we've got to meet those needs somehow. And you only do that with new revenue. With no new revenue, what we've had to do, as you know, is cut service by 30%. At the same time we're doing that, since 1994 forward, we've made a lot of improvements. We've expanded our service to our passengers. We expanded our facilities. And we've done so many things that it's hard to enumerate all of them. But I think it's important for people to understand that we have not had any new resources since 1994. That's how many years?
Well, that's a little more than 15.
Okay,
now.
So could you live your lifestyle now as your kids have grown up, they have to go to school, church, go on vacation, clothes. You know, it's just not fair for people to think that Metro is not living within its means, because we are. We've invested more than $39 million in amenities for bus customers, doing things like transfer centers and free parking facilities. And we've built a number of extensions or added stations to Metrolink in 1994, 98, 2001, 2003, and 2006. So, you know, Metro has done some incredibly important things. And at the same time we're doing that, we've tightened our belt. People say, what are you doing with that money? Well, we're spending it like we're supposed to spend it. But we're tightening our belt. We've done a lot of things here that people ought to also understand. We are not keeping up with inflation. Inflation goes up about 3% a year. Our sales tax revenues in the county and the city this year are going to be down because sales tax revenues are down. But given all of those things, no new income, inflation, all the things that we've done to grow the system, and here we are all these years later, and I think that Metro, in fairness, and the facts I think will prove that has done a tremendous job.
Well, that was my next question to you. How have you done that? How has Metro managed to grow the system without revenue that doesn't keep pace with inflation?
Well, I wish I could take credit for having done those things, but I can't. But I can say Metro and all the people who are involved in management and the employees have done a number of things. And these are not easy things, because we had a freeze salaries for three of the last 4 years. And now, again, think of I mean, you're thankful for a job, but no salary increase in three out of the last 4 years. We've reduced our employee benefits and increased our retirement age. Retirement age used to be 60. It's going to be 65. Mm-hmm. That saves the company money. What we've done on hiring of people, human resources, if you want, is it's been relatively flat. If you look at our expenses over the last 5-6 years, for 4 or 5 of those years, we've been flat. Yeah. I don't think many companies, public or private, can say that. So I think that's a real coup to a feather in a hat of Metro. We haven't added people. We haven't spent money on things that are not related to service. The only time we add people is for safety reasons, or there are critical positions you have to have for maintenance, or bus operators, as the case may be. But we've been very successful with programs that have increased employee efficiency and effectiveness. So again, I think that we've improved our technology. There's more technology at work here now. There's more on the way. There are some exciting things coming for our customers, and we'll be unveiling those a little bit later on. Our vehicle maintenance procurement and program is stellar. We've done that even though the money that we have has not been enough to really do anything incredibly new, our staff has done some things by using spare parts, keeping these buses running probably beyond their useful life. I can't say enough good things about the people in our maintenance division who keep those buses, trains, and vans running.
Well, that has been great.
I think another thing that people don't understand, and we have to continue to help people understand, we have to compete for federal funds. And it's not like just us competing against ourselves. We're competing against the whole country.
Right.
And other transit systems who are better funded than us have local share. Mm-hmm. One of our problems is that we don't always have the local share. But we have successfully competed for federal grants, and that has helped us with our shortfall.
So what you're saying is sometimes we can't qualify for a grant because we don't have the local funds to match that the federal government would require?
Yeah, and I think that's exactly correct. Sometimes we don't have the funds. And, for example, if we want to expand Metro Link, that's going to require federal funds.
Right.
Now it's 50-50, so we would have to apply. But guess what? We've got to get in line behind a whole bunch of other systems throughout the country, places like Dallas and Charlotte, Atlanta, Portland, all cities that have a lot of funds available. So we don't just step to the head of the line. We're in the middle of the pack, or maybe even further back. And that's not something we can allow to happen, because if it does, we won't get the federal funds, we won't grow the system. And I think St. Louis is pretty unique in our situation here, because we're not aware of any other system in the country that had to make the kind of cuts that we've just made. So there's no template, there's no model. So we're doing our best in terms of planning. We're reacting to what we find is happening to our customers. If there are problems, we fix them as quickly as we can. But what we got to do is continue to do that, and we got to do everything we possibly can to be sure our customers are being served to the best of our ability.
Can you say anything more about how we do compare with other cities? How our circumstance is either the same or different than other communities?
Well, I think there's a number of things you can say about St. Louis. We get our money from the local jurisdictions. We get some from the state, not as much from the state as we would like to have, but hopefully this $12 million is coming our way. But we are really at the bottom of the pack in terms of financing per capita citizen. We are also unique because we are one of the best systems in the entire country. The only place that we fall flat is that we're at the bottom of the pack in terms of public funding, public support for Metro. In fact, we just won an international award ranking us among the top five transit systems in the world for our vehicle reliability. The other systems included Seoul, Singapore, Warsaw, and the London Underground. And we were the only North American system to rank in the top five. High honor under any circumstance, so hats off to our maintenance team.
Okay. So, given all of that, what's the outlook, Mr. Baer? Where do you see transit in this region going?
Well, I was asked that question yesterday by Mark Reardon, and he said we're not a Boston, we're not a Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we want to be a Boston or Atlanta. We want to be St. Louis. But we want to be St. Louis that's progressive. We want a great quality of life for all of our citizens, whether they use the system or not. So, you know, we are going to have to come up with a financial plan that allows us to grow the system. There's a great demand out there. We know that last year we had 54 million boardings, 54 right. million. Our call ride requests are at an all-time high, and we just had to cut all that. So when we think about long-term and where we're going next, I think there's a couple components to that. One is a long-range plan
okay.
that defines for the region, as we go out and talk to people, as you know we're doing, about Metro and a permanent source of funding. We want to talk to them about what we and East-West Gateway envision as how the system would grow over the next 5-10 years. We want that to be a bottoms-up plan.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want it to be us telling people what they want. It's the other way around. We want them to tell us what they want, and here's the kicker. They've got to be willing to fund what they want. There's no free lunch.
Okay.
We can't do it on our own. We have no taxing authority. So we've got to determine, we being Metro, East-West Gateway, the elected officials, the business community, our customers, what kind of system does the community want and what are we willing to pay for? And we've got to define for them ways that we may be able to pay for the service they want.
That actually sounds exciting. We'll be looking forward to hearing more about that long-range plan that'll come from you. I want to thank you for your time today, and thank those people who have been watching and listening to Customer Focus. We'll be back in about a month with an update on what's going on with Metro Finances and what's going on with our service on the street. Thanks for joining us.